about cinematics for the lab. But before diving into the presentation, let me introduce myself. I'm Raul Hudea. I'm a computer scientist in the web platform team at Adobe. And I'm been involved with HTML engines for the last 5 years. In the beginning, I worked with WebKit and as part of the Adobe Air project, HTML Logger, if somebody used it. And recently, I'm still working with WebKit, but this time I'm working directly with the open source community around WebKit.org. Also here, you can have some, if you want to know what we are doing, this is the team site that wrote that list what we're doing. And also another interesting site is HTML.com, which actually lists all the important directions that Adobe is doing currently related to HTML. Also, this is my Twitter account. But because I thought that it's nice to have a demo as early as possible, I thought to introduce the agenda by using CSS shaders. We have here the same element, but now it's represented in a more 3D-ish style. Something that can be used to enhance the user experience when bringing when user enters and interacts with your page. With CSS shaders, you can. I will discuss at large CSS shaders later in the talk. But with CSS shaders, you can add some subtlety to how user interacts. This kind is subtle for me, maybe not for you. But we can also have some like more visible effects, like this page flipping effect, which brings me to the agenda. I'm going to talk about the CSS filter effects and CSS shaders, which are part of this spec, and also about CSS compositing and blending spec. These are actually two specs that Adobe contributes to both the writing the spec and also to contributing implementation to the WebKit browser. But let's start. First is CSS filters. CSS filters are a way of modifying the rendering of an HTML5 element in a way that that applies not only to images but also to actual HTML elements like div, p elements, and so on. The most important thing is, like I said, there are ways of changing the rendering of the content, and more important is that they apply to all contents. Because if we are talking about images, Canvas offers us APIs for drawing the image on top of Canvas, but then also to read the pixel information from that image. And having this information, you can basically create whatever effect you want. For example, to use CSS filters, you actually have to use the filter CSS property, and then you have to pass one of these functions that are grayscale, CPI, invert, saturate. Original actually is not a function, it's just for comparison. And by looking at this slide, initially I thought that I might add some type of cryptogram or something, because it's very similar to one product. There is also another filter missing from here. It didn't enter this page. It's like drop shadow. So basically, with shortened filters, it covers, I think, most of the developer common needs. For example, almost every gallery, image gallery around the world can be improved using filters. And for example, I looked at one. At one gallery, this is the one from the Apple. This is like a showcase for HTML5. And how they are actually implemented this is that they are having two different sets of images. One is the unblurred one, and the other one is the blurred one. So in CSS filters, you can easily have only one set of images, and apply the blur filter for the one from the back. And by doing this, you can also improve the bandwidth and save some money, depending on your site. And also, what's more important, it can apply to any HTML content, not just images. And they are hardware accelerated on most browsers that support them. Another way of using CSS filters is by using SVG filters, which actually is the first implementation of filters. CSS filters grow out of the SVG filter spec, which is like 5 years or 6 years old already. And it's actually started when Mozilla experimented with using SVG filters and allowing it to be applied on HTML content and not only to SVG content. The syntax is similar to the shorthand functions. Instead of the functions, you have to specify the ID of the SVG filter. One thing that can be noted here is that you actually cannot pass any arguments to these functions, to these filters. But because the SVG filter is put in a declarative format inside the SVG content, in the SVG markup, you can actually use JavaScript to change the attributes of that declarative type. And for example, here I have a simple filter, and with the slide, with this slide, I can easily change the position of the light in this filter. So I can play with it. So with SVG filter, like I said, you cannot currently use it for passing arguments. You have to use JavaScript for that. Applies only to SVG content, with the exception of the Firefox, which started the CSS filter spec by allowing SVG filters to be applied to HTML content. And actually, I saw that 1 week ago, a patch went into WebKit that allows SVG filters to be applied to HTML content. I10 only allows it to use filters on SVG content. One thing about SVG filters is that they can be more complex than the CSS filter shorthands. Actually, the shorthands are, this is what they are, shorthand for a combination of SVG filters that are covered the most common use. Because the SVG filters are made as a graph of, here I have the example of the filter that I used. And you can see that you can actually say what kind of input you want from the output of the other filters. And this is very important because in the case of shorthand filters, everything is linear. So you can have like grayscale, sepia, invert, and everything, the output of the first filter becomes the input of the next filter. In SVG, you can actually create a graph and specify which output is which input for whatever filter predictor. And also, more importantly, in SVG, you also have access to the alpha channel, which allows you to create that biometric effect that I've shown previously. The third way of using filters is by using CSS shaders. If you were at the talk before, they were discussing a little bit about shaders, which are actually small programs that run directly on the GPU. Actually, the GPS shaders started as an internship project in Adobe Romania, and it moved very quickly, and it actually got presented at Adobe Max, which is like the biggest developer conference of Adobe in that year. And although this was a separate spec as it started, it eventually becomes part of the CSS filter spec. So, to use CSS shaders, we see that we have to use the same filter CSS property, but we have to specify this custom function and pass the parameters, which are like shaders. And here we have the parameters. The vertex shader is the single, the mandatory parameter that has to be passed to this custom function. Then we can specify fragment shader, the vertex mesh, and also parameters that are custom to the shaders. The vertex shader, we, in order to use it, you have to specify the location of this shader, and also specify the vertex mesh. This is a representation of the vertex mesh that's applied to the texture of the rendering of the HTML element. And it is different from the other filters, and this is the specificity of the CSS shaders, is that it can alter the 3D geometry of the element, which all the other filters only change the color of the, can change the color of the pixels. This can also change the 3D geometry for this. The fragment shaders is similar in, you have to also specify the URL for this fragment shader. And it has only one sole purpose, which is to actually decide the pixel color for that render. And because it is called for each pixel on the image, it actually receives interpolated data from the vertex shader. For example, if you want to decide pixel here, the color pixel here, initially it receives colors from these four vertices or three vertices. I'm not exactly depends, I think. When you want to, if you specify various arguments after the vertex mesh, these parameters, these arguments are passed to each shader. And here I have, for example, this this slider, and we see that initially when the amount is zero, is like everything is gray, and as we move, it starts to do some wobble effect, and then each colors moves from down to up. This is actually a live shader here. Okay, let's see how why do you want to, why you would like to use shaders? Because they are, I have seen, rather easy to use, and because they run on GPU hardware, they are hardware accelerated, and it allows both pixel and geometry manipulation. And now let's take a look of the shader code to see how it looks. Let's start with the vertex code. These vertex code are, these vertex shader are called for each vertex on the vertex mesh, and they receive several parameters, several arguments that are specific to them. Like this, in this case, I only have like two. There are more. The A position represents the position inside the 3D space, while the A-tex coordinate represents the position inside the textures that is that represents the rendering of the HTML element. And also, it receives like this uniform type of variables called like projection matrix, which allows the translation from the 3D space to the 2D space specific to the screen. And also another type of variables that can be used inside shaders are the varying types, which are used to pass information between the vertex shader and the fragment shader. The other uniform variables are actually represented by the custom parameters that are set inside the CSS project. And the most important thing that the vertex shader has to do is to decide the final position of the vertex in the 2D space. The fragment code, the fragment shader is similar to the vertex shader, except it doesn't have all the parameters that are specific to the vertex shader, like the A position, and also has the varying variable to allow it to receive information for the vertex shader. But what is probably most important here is that For those familiar with OpenGL, it doesn't have the GL flag color, which is the usual way of setting the color of the fragment shader. We use like a CSS blend color, which is a custom variable, and this was because of the security that occurred during the review from the working group community, the CSS working group community. So, what were the problems with the CSS shaders? The problem was that shaders might allow other third party to access the rendered content, and this might actually lead to reading the various information like your bank information if you are having an iframe and applying the CSS shader on that one, and also it can be used to read the browser specific information like the visited links, which should not be linked to third parties. And how can this happen is by using a so-called timing attack, which works like this. You initially in the fragment shader you read the pixel color, and then depending on the color of the pixel you stay more time or less time inside the shader. And then reading the timing, you can time this the shader execution, and from this you can infer actually the data of what is actually rendered there. This happened like the previous presenter said for WebGL, where you can actually, I also tested, you can actually see an image how it was reproduced via shaders, and you can distinguish what it was actually in that thing. And we also, unfortunately, we managed to do a timing attack in our initial prototype. So what we were eventually do is to rewrite the shader code, and this is possible in Chrome because they use the Angle library, which is a layer between the original OpenGLS code and the hardware, which can be either OpenGL or DirectX. And inside the Angle library, we eliminate every color-based decision. If they are trying to do an if, a loop, or something that is using color as a variable, we drop that shader. So this might be restrictive, but actually lots of the initial samples that we made with the original prototype were able to be replicated with this restriction too. We also analyze other GPU execution patterns to see whether there are some other ways of eliminating this restrictive way. But for now, we go to eliminate every risk that we can do. Because CSS shaders might be a little difficult to write, we foresee that for CSS shader there might be like most of the shader will be written by a group of skilled developers, but most of the developers will use those written shaders and use them. So we thought about creating an application that allows developers to actually interact with the shader and see whether they can create their needed effect. So this is still not yet released, but I have a demo here. So this is also on the web, and here, for example, we have like this is like the vertex mesh, and we can just modify it a little and see what's happening. And here we have like a panel, and we see what are the CSS property look like. So you have only just to copy paste it in your in your website. So another interesting part is, for example, that you can use it to create animation. And for example, I here and I start. This is like an HTML element. Everything here can be selected. And let's say, so, for example, like this. And then move here and say like, so like this. And maybe even more. And then here. If I play, you see how it creates an animation effect. And here you have all the WebKit, the animations that are being used for this one. So you also can copy paste it in your site. Let me move back to the presentation. The last part that I want to talk about is the CSS compositing and blending. Why do we want to add this to the web, to the browsers? Because they are very common idiom for designers. Everybody, the designers are already used to this kind of idioms if they are using Photoshop or other image related tools, and it can be very easily described with simple keywords, and actually it can be very easy to implement by browser vendors. We did a prototype for both WebKit and Firefox, and it was very easy to do because they were already implemented as part of the SVG specification. So we only had to expose them and allow them to be applied to HTML. But what is compositing? Compositing is the way of how two graphical objects combine. And in the case of the alpha compositing, it's using alpha channel to decide how two objects combine. The alpha channel actually represents the opacity of an object. So this can be used, for example, only very easy to just specify the CSS alpha compositing property and set a value of the 12 compositing operators that were actually described by Porter and Duff sometimes in 1984. And as you see, they are using source and destination to name them. Source will represent the initial object, in this case is the rectangle, and the destination is the backdrop, which is the image in this case. The default parameters is source over. So, for example, if we can, I said here, it just removes the source. Here with source, it only lets the source to be visible. Transparency with destination, only destination. With source, it only lets some the part of the source that is inside the destination. The destination, I'm not sure if it's visible, but it's also transparency there. It's only let the, with source out, it eliminates the source that is inside the destination. Destination out, similarly. And these are others. So I am sure that the designers that are using Photoshop or other tools, they are very used to this kind of compositing. If alpha compositing relates to the transparency, the blending refers to how colors of the source and destination actually combine together. So this is also very easy to use. Just have to specify blend mode as a CSS property and then use value as one of the listed here. I'm also sure that I've seen this kind of naming, but I didn't know how to use them. Designer by heart, so. But we can see that if we apply, they can change, and probably people will recognize the effect here. Another interesting part is that having filters and blending, we can actually create new effects, like I say, so soft glow effect. Here, for example, we have two images that are put on one on top of the other, and if I apply, for example, blur on the first image, on the top image, and then apply blend mode, this in this case is lighten, we can see how it's like a glowing effect, and we can see that this is only the first one that is having this effect applied. And probably some other effects can be created by combining this effect. So, what is the current status for these features? CSS filters are, as shorthands in this case, are available in Chrome starting with version 18. And they are already hardware accelerated and applied to also video and other hardware accelerated content. CSS shaders, and also related to CSS filters, I've heard some rumor that might be available on Safari 5.2 inside the Mountain Lion, but I'm not sure. Yeah. CSS shaders is a work in progress. We managed to figure out the security issues with that, so we actually committed all the needed changes inside the Angular library. And now we are starting to finalize what we have left of enabling shaders inside the Chrome. CSS blending and compositing is also a work in progress, but we expect that this will work much faster because it was very easy to implement by Firefox and Chrome. We have access to the source code, so we can actually implement that and see how it goes. And despite the fact that this is a very recent specification, it only was publicly released, you know, this spring. It gained traction for most guys because it was like a very obvious spec, and we are hoping that it will be finalized, maybe get into revision draft or editor's draft or working draft soon later this year. That would be it. This presentation was is an HTML presentation using Revit.js. These are some fonts and images that I used. If you want to experiment with everything that I discussed today, you can go to html.com. You can download the prototype build. You can also look at the source code of the prototype build. It's all there on the GitHub. And also play with shaders, with CSS blending and compositing. Not yet with the CSS Shader Studio, but we plan to release that quite soon. Okay, thank you. That's it. Okay. Thank you again.